I presume that the audience is a bit exhausted, and so I simply will be gathering some of my comments on this project. The organizers of the conference asked me to make some comments on the project of the General History of Latvia just now, after already published the fifth volume of the Global Art History, because its concept and moreover the issue resolved could reveal some methodological theoretical problems in line with some suggested topics of the conference. The first title of this and other volumes will denote all the seven volumes project, already begun in 2012-2013, could certainly indicate also a well-known problem concerning the so-called construction of national art histories. Maybe I will be a bit tautological, but nevertheless, yes. And in fact, their legitimation is the titles point to a national political topography, but Latvia as a national state emerged only in 1918. Authors of the project were and are well aware of the problem. It goes without saying that they did not intend to construct an ethnocentric or nationalistic art history, ignoring present-day Latvia's political and cultural past, then the region belonged to the Russian Empire or was divided, governed by Swedish, Polish forces, especially German upper class, which had its roots in the epoch of Christianization, the Northern Crusade. Art history of Latvia is a very conditioned and conventional title, which tells, first of all, that the discussed region for centuries has been mainly populated by ethnic Latvians, whose language and culture did the so-called folk art before the end of the 19th century, or fine art later become the sign of regional specificity. All innumerable artists and artworks of different ethnic origins, primary Baltic Germans and their art within the region are or tightly related to it, were regarded as an integral part of its art history. Self-evident and necessary context of European art is and will be charted by softest of influences and analogies from other regions and centers. Besides that, it is obvious that original and noteworthy information about the art of the past could be obtained by present-day Latvian art historians when mainly, I stress mainly, local artifacts and written sources within the reach. That means in situ, in archives and local libraries, art research. We cannot pretend to offer any new and important insights concerning, for instance, Rembrandt, Picasso, or Churchill. It doesn't mean that we are not intending to cooperate with art historians from other countries and centers. For instance, the forthcoming international project on medieval architecture in Ionia, which will be a joint venture of German, Estonian, and Latin researchers, no doubt will provide important information also for the first volume of our art history. The second and still actual problem was to present the broader socio-political context of art making and art consuming in Latvia. It should be remembered looking back that art history in Latvia during the Soviet rule was heavily damaged by the dogmatic Marxist sociological method imposed on the interpretation of activities of Latvian art historians of the Soviet time. After intact. In published texts, especially on the modern art, they simply degenerated into assertions which signalized the author's political loyalty to the official ideology of the time. After the collapse of Soviet regime, Latvian art historians happily returned to the free art the history. To the free art history, in quotation marks, yeah, that means again into empirical truths about global art in the past and the stylistic generalizations, which was the most stable local tradition of art history making. Paradigmatically, it could be named back to Berlin, or within the local tradition, maybe back to Wilhelm Neumann. It was rather a surprise to acknowledge at that time, at least for me, that a substantial part of art historians in the free Western world, especially in the Anglophone countries, developed in just the opposite direction. I mean the so-called new art history or radical art history, as it was named by Jonathan Harris in his monograph on the Academy. I do not intend now to analyze it and to list all its concepts and ingredients, but it is clear that neo-Marxist sociology was the essential part of its theoretical base. A question which could be posed at that time, is it the necessary logical model for Latvian art history? The possible local allergy to it would be understandable, and some so familiar exaggerations found in the works of Western adepts of this current could be cautious art historian who knew the dogma of interpretational model, this interpretation model, only too well. Speaking personally, I was not sure that at that time that I could accept, for instance, paintings Matisse as an instrument of French colonialism, as it was stated by James Herbert, or French impressionists as painters who helped bourgeoisie to forget Paris Commune Revolution, as it was stated by Albert Boehm. I think that similar allergic reactions had also other art historians who had encountered forms of dogmatic Marxism imposed on the art history of the Soviet bloc in the countries. As a Czech art historian, Milana Bartová asserts in her recent survey of Marxism in Czech art history, I quote, distrust towards any methodology oriented on social or and political framing of artistic production and meaning pervades the mainstream of Czech art history until today. You know, make a strong assertion. Let us take another recent trend, post-colonial theory and post-colonial studies regarding local culture and therefore also imperial art. At first it seems more appropriate if we agree to call Latvia and its regions a colony ruled by Germans, Swedes, Russia or Soviet Union. It could be remembered that during the Nazi occupation, Niels von Holst, German art historian, approvingly and simply named Baltic art German colonial art. Such simplified precedent certainly cannot be valid now. Are these terms, colony, colonial, their notion and connotation, and adequate guidelines for the interpretation of all local artifacts? In the spirit of modern colonial studies, one should critically focus on the relations between the ruling powers of foreign invaders and indigenous people in the realm of clashes of cultures, or maybe of a blend of them. It was already somehow done, now we're using different terms and without convincing results during 1930s and in the early Soviet time. For instance, some historians of the late 30s try to tame the legacy of historical styles which are regarded as alien to ethnic Latvians. As it is known, Boris Ripper offered the useful concept of respectalization of historical styles, which was useful just in this regard, and made it possible to identify in those historical styles peasant, that means that twin elements. One of his examples, and in this case a simple mistake, and then there were other two. After the Second World War, the local monuments of historical styles regarded by Soviet officials as alien to new socialist society and as the legacy of former oppressors, Baltic German overlords, their research and preservation was hindered and became impossible with the reservation only later during the last decades of the Soviet rule. Of course, we should admit, it is important to review the relations between our mating and confronting social strata, but is it the main and sole objective of a general art history of this region? Now, in the second decade of the 21st century, conceiving our general academic history of art, these dramatic options, back to Wolfen or back to Marx, seem already irrelevant. The description of political, social, economic and technological factors which influence and determine the creation and consumption of artifacts was indisputably important and inevitable in extended texts, along with the detailed display of artistic life, institutions and processes, art education, art societies, art collections, exhibitions, how art was received in press and the art market. Here are two titles of chapters and some pages of this part of the book. Nevertheless, this does not mean that our works have become only illustrations of socio-political history instead of being made objects of interpretation. Focusing on art remains the dominant aspect of this and other volumes. Simply because these volumes are about art, as it is indicated by titles of volumes, not about something else, notwithstanding the shifting contemporary idea of art and the broad spectrum of its definition. Regarding the choice of phenomena of local culture with attributes of art, for certain, the cultus of artifacts was not only so traditionally called fine or high art, but also applied art, scenography, photography, and even popular design production, including, for instance, graphic design, even product packaging labels, trademarks and logos, postage stamps, and etc. If only those phenomena could be interpreted as fulfilling aesthetic functions for contemporaries or later, at least to some extent, at least to some minimal extent. It was an approximate criteria which permitted to differentiate such utilitarian products from the mass of phenomena which is the subject for the fashionable and for certain quite legitimate visual culture studies. Yeah. Published volumes and also forthcoming ones are the result of collective works by scholars for experts in particular fields of research. Here are the photos, in fact, not only authors, all the team. Each author could independently interpret the piece of her materials. We were Democrats in that regard. Texts are not just certainly the outcome of contributors' individual studies, but a synthesis of many other artist audience researchers do. And nevertheless, interpretation role of each author was crucial. However, the texts were made and coordinated, taking in account the genre of general art history. The scope of texts was not conceived as a collection of thematically disconnected articles within the broad framework of the art history of Latvia. Medium specifics of the big groups of artifacts was the objective reason for the pathological division of texts. Each chapter is devoted to one branch of art of the time under discussion. Historical prefaces, historiography, the surveys of artistic life constitute the context of all branches. For instance, in the fifth volume, after historiography and artistic life, successively branches of the fine art. The painting, graphic art, and sculpture are discussed and follows the stage design, book art, and photography. Next parts deal with architecture, applied art, and design, the series in which visual aesthetics is combined with utilitarian functions. The selection and emphasis on the particular artists, artworks, and their groups was determined by the greater or lesser conformity to typological generalization, the path of development and changes, as well as the so-called canonical values. Of course, considering the relative nature of each author's right to reasonably dispute or complement them. Concerning the general terminology of just published volume, the general stylistic terms used in the volume and its title are of course conditional. The term of classical modernism, which was derived from German art history in due time by our colleague from the National Museum, Dutz Lamberger, appeared quite convenient because it refers just to the term of the century, neo-romanticist modernism's third evolution, a transition to more abstract imagery, often expressed in rationalized geometric forms that developed in architecture and design too. Also, all encompassing was the period's increasing traditionalism, including both the return to mimetic representation of reality and strengthening the neoclassicism and that tradition. About names and the concept of periodization. If we partly accept Meyer-Shapiro classification, then we use combined cultural, aesthetic, or stylistic and political criteria. Here is a list with volumes, titles, some of them are certainly provisional. Stone Age or medieval art cultures, Baroque or Classicism are for sure stylistic terms. The phase of two occupations refers to politics. That means that accepted criteria of periodization was manifold, considering different factors which shape the real artistic life and art. An explanatory example concerning the fifth volume. The first number, 1915, of the period denotes the beginning of a significant continuous development of classical and modernism in Latvian art, which was initiated by artists' vision and performative force. That means it was begun by inner artistic impulse by those young men. The end point of the period clearly points out to the external political factor that abruptly changed the flow of the development of art and Latvia. When general changes of artifacts are detected, then one should find the main cause of them, and it would be either artistic or socio-political or maybe technological. Concerning the overall, or better say to say intrinsic organization of the information delivered by authors in their text, content and structure of texts were determined by the idea of general art history as a process of changes encompassing artworks as well as conditions of their creation and consumption, in which the output and biographical data of particular artists subordinated to general conclusions. the course of transformations was not synchronous in different kinds of art, and the structure of each text was individually varied. Still, a common developmental trajectory has emerged with the escalation of abstract in modernism in the Arabic period. Here is some examples. Increasing proportion of traditional paper. Next examples. And the growing impact of authoritarian rule by the end of the period. The linguistic signs that the new wave of modernism could be expected, for instance, in the realm of painting with the guise of neo-fauvism. However, this process was disrupted by the Soviet occupation in the 1940s. Well, that's all about this book in short. Yes. Finishing my comments and outside the historiographical discourse, I can assert that authors of the book are grateful to all colleagues, institutions, and individuals who supported and endorsed the work on this publication, not only in that, but also outside. For instance, all coming from Vilnius, Gabriel Kevichus, and Jeremy Hover from St. Andrews, yes. Thank you for your attention. And only one to supplement. I'm sure that all the participants of the conference could get this volume if they want to get it, yes. Only they should sign a paper. Thank you for your attention.